Good afternoon. Please be seated. I'm Dean Grover Cleveland Gilmore, and it's my great honor to welcome you here. For those of you who got here a little bit early, I want you to know that it stopped raining, and it's a beautiful blue sky outside, so you can look forward to that when this ceremony is over. Welcome to the 2016 Diploma Ceremony of the Jack, Joseph, and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences at Case Western Reserve University. This is a very special year for us because we've begun celebrating our centennial. We were chartered in 1915, and the first students entered in 1916. We're celebrating by having 100 weeks of centennial celebration, and we're right at our midpoint, and what a great celebration at the midpoint of that centennial celebration year. The school was started at the request of civic leaders in Cleveland. They came forward and told the president and the trustees of the university that they saw a need in the city of Cleveland, a large, growing, industrial city, a need to support people, to support families. And the trustees met and they decided to answer that call. And as such, we became the first professional graduate school established at an American university for the study of social work, which at the time was described as applied social sciences. So graduates can be very proud to be at a school that not only was the first, but more importantly, I believe, responded to the needs of the community, even in its founding. Each year we are joined by alumni who are living the mission of the school. I would like the alumni who are here to please stand and be recognized. Thank you. Graduates, we are here to celebrate your accomplishments. Each of you is outstanding and will go forward to change the world. You truly are change agents. We want to congratulate you on reaching this very special moment of the day. Of course, you are not alone on this journey. Thanks to you have many people to thank you for supporting you along the way. Your family members, your friends, and many are with you today. And I'd like you to stand and to thank them by applauding. Applaud. Your faculty and your advisors have also helped you to reach this day. These dedicated individuals have worked hard to provide excellent educational experiences for you. Faculty members and field advisors, would you please all stand to be recognized by the graduates? I want to tell you that during the ceremony, you may see some faculty leaving. It's not because of my lengthy remarks. It's because we also have a PhD program, and the people who are graduating in that ceremony have been supported by their faculty, and their faculty advisors will be leaving in order to participate in the ceremony for the doctoral students. So I'm very appreciative of the faculty who have taken their time this morning to be here with you and who are going off to help also their doctoral students. It's with great pleasure that I introduce the Mandel School graduate student speaker. Nominated by her peers to represent the 2016 graduate class, Melissa Pantel-Koo is our speaker. Melissa, would you please come forward?
Thank you. thank you so much for the honor of addressing my fellow graduates, as well as the faculty, staff, and field instructors who have taught and worked with us, and the family and friends who have supported us as we've pursued our degrees. I'd like to talk to you today about walls. A few years ago, I had one last job interview for a career that never really got off the ground. This career was never a good fit for me, and I was absolutely dreading this interview because it represented all of these old feelings, all of the shoulds, other people's expectations, and my sense of not being enough. I was so nervous about this interview that I literally ran into a wall. Somehow, I forgot to open the garage door, I backed up without looking, and ran my car into the door. With a start like that, you can imagine how the interview went. And when I came home, I said, I'm done. I finally admitted to myself that this career was not what I wanted. It took 2 more years after that before I came to MSAS, but running into that garage door allowed me, finally, to let go of a piece of my past that was not working for me. Many of us personally have run into some kind of wall, or we've been close to someone who has. We also feel outraged as we see fellow human beings walled in by poverty, injustice, discrimination, and mental or physical illness. As I've gotten to know many of you during the past 2 years, I've learned that these deeply personal challenges and feelings are a large part of what's driven us toward careers in social work. We've taken pain, channeled it through a defense mechanism or two, combined it with some evidence-based practices, and now we're ready to get to work. As social workers, a lot of what we'll be doing and what we've done already in our field placements is helping client systems and clients who have run into walls. A community confronting police brutality, a nonprofit facing drastic budget cuts, a child struggling with the effects of abuse and neglect, a young adult grappling with his first psychotic break, a mother confronting her substance abuse, a veteran coping with the physical and emotional scars of war. Sadly, there is no shortage of clients. These clients are going to need us, whether they go at their wall with a sledgehammer or they chip away at it bit by bit. Some of our clients are going to run into their walls head on, over and over. Others may peek at their walls and cover their eyes, too afraid to face them. Some will get a running start and jump right over, but later realize that slowly examining each brick might have served them better. And for many clients, getting over the wall is only the beginning. They're going to need our help as they build new lives on the other side, because it's so different from what they've been used to. The past 2 months, I've been working with a client who is unhappy with her situation, but she is just not ready to change. I've been standing at the base of the wall, offering her a way to get over, and she refuses to do it. While it's been a huge challenge for me to accept this, ultimately it's been a very important lesson as I begin my social work career. My role has been to give this client a boost so that she can see over the wall, so that she gets a glimpse of what might be if and when she decides to make a change. I wish all of you strength in the years to come. We're going to need it to help the clients who are ready for change, and we'll definitely need it as we work with those who are not. It's inevitable that we will run into walls in our professional lives. Social work, as we know, is an intense career. We're going to see a lot, we're going to hear a lot, and we're going to feel a lot. Let's be there for each other. I urge you to draw strength from our cohort and from the larger MSAS community, for ourselves and for our clients. Each and every client needs our skills and our passion. Stand by your client's side, face the wall, and know that simply by standing there, you have made a difference. Thank you.
Well, I can certainly see why you chose Melissa. Beautiful remarks. Thank you. I'm pleased to begin the presentation of awards with the Irene Sogg Gross Award. This award is selected by Mandel School students for a fellow classmate. At this time, I would like the current president of the Mandel Council for Student Community Leadership, Jasmine Danner, to come forward to present the award. Jasmine?
The Irene Sogg Gross Award was established by Mr. Milton Gross to honor his wife, an MSAS graduate of 1940. It is given to a member of the graduating class chosen by their peers in recognition of outstanding interests and accomplishments in the area of humanitarian services. The award is based on two premises: unusual capacity of human understanding and demonstration of evidence of social service through curricular and extracurricular activities. This year's winner of the Irene Sog Gross Award exemplifies all the noted qualities. Student nominations state that this sensitive and outspoken student activist has worked by creating a sustainable and transformative environment of healing and hope for the family and broader community of the 12-year-old Tamir Rice. Another student states that this student has been applying what we learned about community empowerment to heal the community after the shooting death of Tamir Rice through working with the Butterfly Project. The 2016 Irene Saw Gross Award goes to Shelley Grayson. Shelley, please come forward to accept this award.
The John A. Yankee Student Community Service Award is presented to a graduate who has actively engaged as a volunteer in one or more successful community service activities or projects while a student at the Mandel School. The spirit of the award is to recognize a student who exemplifies Emeritus Professor John A. Yankee's dedication to community service and his desire to strengthen the nonprofit sector. The award brings public attention to the extensive commitment of students to the nonprofit sector and provides the opportunity to highlight both the students' involvement and the organization. A summary of comments from faculty nominations include the following. The graduate serves on the Professional Development Committee of the Case Graduate Student Council. She is an amazing leader and has developed a number of activities for our students and other graduate students to connect together and receive extracurricular education. She was on the planning committee of the Professional Development Conference held this semester on campus for all graduate students. Hundreds of students participated in a very successful conference. She took the content of a session on conflict management to her field agency, the Free Clinic. They have now asked the faculty member to present this session to their entire staff. This exemplifies the way in which this graduate connects nonprofits to resources and is a great networker. She demonstrates enthusiasm, a commitment to excellence, and respect for all she encounters. I am pleased to present the 2016 John A. Yankee Student Community Service Award to Brianna Usher. Mandel School's Dean's Award for Outstanding Student Achievement is presented to a graduate or graduates whom faculty feel exhibits academic achievement, exceptional service to the school, and exemplary performance in field education. This year, two students have been selected for the award. The awards are being presented in alphabetical order. I ask that both recipients wait until I've read the commendation for both and then come to the stage. This gives you a moment to get ready. The first graduate was nominated because of her leadership, service to the Mandel Council, service to the school, and to the social work profession. This graduate is someone who will always show up to help and will give her best effort. She took over the Mandel Council leadership after the elected president had to step down, and she did so with humility and grace. Consistently, this graduate is seen at Mandel School events and community events. She appreciates the broad range of opportunities available to social work practitioners in both macro and micro specializations, and knows that social work practitioners use all level of interventions to sponsor social change. She's been an energetic member of the Mandel School community during her time here and will continue to be an active ambassador for the Mandel School after graduation. Her achievement in coursework and service have been above the usual standard of excellence we set for Mandel students. For all of her accomplishments in leadership, I'm pleased to present the 2016 Dean's Award for Outstanding Achievement to Deb Crane. And now the next person. Our next graduate has demonstrated strong academic achievement and has consistently presented herself as a focused and driven student. She impressed faculty with the effort she put forth in her coursework, her ease at working collaboratively with other students, her critical thinking skills, and the quality of work independently produced. Through her participation in discussions and learning activities, she was able to not only promote her own learning, but also facilitated other students' levels of engagement, which the instructors believe led to deeper understanding and learning of the course content for the whole class. She clearly emerged as a leader in the classroom. She has also demonstrated exceptional service to the Mandel School and to the community. Among a long list of community and school service, I will note a few. She was an active member of the Student Leaders Advocating for Mental Health, SLAM, Project Hope's Freedom Run, and has organized monthly peer-to-peer self-care groups to support her fellow students in maintaining optimal mental and emotional health while pursuing the MSSA degree. For all of her accomplishments in leadership, I am pleased to present the 2016 Dean's Award for Outstanding Student Achievement to Catherine Weaver. And now please come forward. We are so fortunate to have a leadership among our students as represented by these individuals, but also by all of you sitting in the audience. And I have appreciated over the last few years going to our events and seeing you there, not only participating, but making things happen. So thank you so much. Each year we have the opportunity to recognize one individual as outstanding field instructor. Field instructors are the social workers in the agencies who work without extra pay to help students develop their professional skills, apply the classroom theory to the realities of today's service delivery challenges, and develop their identities as professional social workers. They do it because they are committed to students and the future of the profession. Here are some student comments about this year's awardee. She wholeheartedly challenged me, helped break down my walls, and was there to rebuild my professional confidence when graduate work was vastly overwhelming. She has taught me so many things about being a professional, understanding my worth, and keeping my standards high regardless of pushback, and I will be forever grateful for her presence in my field experience. She truly cares about her students and does everything in her power to help them succeed and grow. is with great pleasure that I announce this year's Field Instructor of the Year, Kimberly McFarlane. We are now going to present the Outstanding Teacher of the Year Award for full-time teaching. And the president of the Mandel School Alumni Association, Annette Iwamoto, will make the presentation.
Thank you, Dean Gilmore, our welcomed guests, faculty, and graduates. It is a special honor for me to be with our centennial graduating class, 100 years of proud service for the benefit of all. As president of the Mandel School Alumni Association, may I welcome the centennial class of 2016 to our ranks. Today you join nearly 8,000 Mandel graduates from all 50 states and 36 countries across the globe. As alumni, we feel strongly connected to the school. Our greatest goal is to raise scholarship money to help offset the cost of tuition for students. Last year, we raised nearly $133,000 from alumni and friends that went directly into financial aid. Now that you're officially alumni, remember us when you receive our annual call. Please save the date for your first reunion to be held on Saturday, October 15th. This year's graduates receive complimentary tickets. Please stop by the Alumni Association table back at the school for a special graduation gift from the Alumni Association. The Alumni Association is also proud to be involved in the presentation of the Outstanding Teacher Awards. The awards honor Emeritus Professor Dr. John Yankee, who was nominated a record number of times as Outstanding Teacher for his ability to enlighten, motivate, and inspire. Although this award focuses on one individual today, it is a testimony to the tremendous talent and commitment of each and every one of our faculty members who teach at the Mandel School. Please join me in thanking our entire faculty for their extraordinary commitment to the education of our students. Here are selective student comments about our full-time faculty award winner. Her extensive child welfare background informs classroom discussion and case studies, which bring clinical concepts to life in such practical ways. This professor took time to ask, listen, and respond to students' many questions, yet managed class time efficiently, ensuring all required materials were covered and assignments clearly conveyed. She went to great lengths to provide students access to and an understanding of the importance of self-care, while also demonstrating self-care strategies in each class. This professor passionately and professionally represented the ideals, values, and ethics important to the social work profession. The outstanding faculty member of the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences is Dr. Zoe Brinwood. Please come accept this award.
There's one more award that would be given today. Our commencement speaker, Connie Schultz, is receiving the Advocate for Human Rights Award. Connie Schultz is a nationally syndicated columnist for Creators Syndicate and a professional in residence at Kent State University. In 2005, she won the 2005 Pulitzer Prize for Commentary for columns that judges praised for providing a voice for the underdog and the underprivileged. Her work has appeared in the New York Times, the Washington Post, Politico, Parade, The Atlantic, ESPN Magazine, and Democracy Journal. Also in 2005, Schultz won the Scripps Howard National Journalism Award for Commentary and the National Headliner Award for Commentary. In 2003, she was a Pulitzer Prize finalist in feature writing for her series, The Burden of Innocence, which chronicled the ordeal of Michael Green, who was imprisoned for 13 years for a rape he did not commit. The week after her series ran, the real rapist turned himself in after reading her stories. The series won the Robert F. Kennedy Award for Social Justice Reporting, the National Headliners Award, Best of Show, and Journalism Awards from Harvard and Columbia Universities. In 2004, Schultz won the Batten Medal, which honors a body of journalistic work that reflects compassion, courage, humanity, and a deep concern for the underdog. Schultz is also a fellow with the Vietnam Reporting Project. Her 2011 series, Unfinished Business, explored the long-term impact of Agent Orange in the U.S. and in Vietnam. Recently, the series won the Associated Press Managing Editor's Journalism Excellence Award in International Perspective. She has received 6 honorary degrees, and for the last 2 years has served as a Pulitzer Prize juror. Schultz is the author of 2 books published by Random House, Life Happens and Other Unavoidable Truths, a collection of essays, and His Lovely Wife, a memoir about her husband Sherrod Brown's successful 2006 race for the U.S. Senate. She's currently working on her first novel. Schultz and her husband have 4 grown children and 5 grandchildren. They live in Cleveland, Ohio, with their rescue dog, Franklin. In many ways, Connie is a change agent. She uses the power of the pen to bring about transformation in our society. Her writing inspires thoughts and actions which lead to positive social change. As we saw with the Michael Green case, she's willing to put her reputation on the line for truth and fairness. She speaks for those who are innocent and need help, but for whom justice failed. She defends them in her communication and urges the community to take action to assist them in their plight. Her Pulitzer Prize-winning pieces enlighten us, provide us with new perspectives, and help us walk in others' shoes, which moves all of us closer to social progress. Many of these characteristics are those of social workers and nonprofit leaders who give a voice to those who don't have one. And we know that advocating and fighting for justice through words and actions are essential in order to be a change agent. Therefore, for her significant contributions as a leader, role model, and creator of opportunities for others, the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences proudly bestows upon Connie Schultz the Mandel School Advocate for Human Rights Award.
I just want you to know that award is much bigger than the Pulitzer Prize. It's really big. Well, this is quite an honor. When I agreed to give this commencement address, I did not know that I was going to receive that award. And the first person I told was my husband. And as his wont, I got a very tearful response. I want to acknowledge 2 family members who are here with me this morning. My brother-in-law, Robert Clark Brown, who is treasurer of Case Western Reserve University. I don't think Bob has ever heard me give a speech before, and I don't know what he will think of it, but being a member of the Brown family, I am certain that he will let me know. And my husband, U.S. Senator Sherrod Brown, is here. I am often asked how I knew when I was in love with Sherrod, when I had fallen in love. I had been a long-time single mother for a decade when I met Sherrod, and I think they want some really highfalutin answer, something about, you know, his heroic deeds in Congress and all the things that he's done for the country, which matter so much to me. But frankly, the moment I knew was when the first time he offered to make coffee for me instead of my making my own coffee, and I assured him that independent me was quite capable of making my own coffee, and thank you very much, and I'll go do that. And he turned to me and he put his hands on my shoulders. He said, please sit down, we need to talk. And then he said, you are not giving up your right to own property or to vote by letting me make your coffee. And that is when I knew I was in love with Sherrod Brown. Dean Gilmore, thank you for those kind words. Thank you for this invitation. Thank you to the faculty. I've met so many of your faculty here this morning. Wow, the stories they have and their own stories that they have. Thank you to all the administration who is here, all the family and friends, and to you, the graduates, most of all, to you. And I also want us to acknowledge all the invisible people, most of whom you haven't seen, which is why I'm calling them invisible, who made this day possible for us today, all the staff and all the volunteers. We are always lifted up highest by the people we seldom see, and I want to make sure that we acknowledge them as well today. So please join me in thanking them. Thank you. When you are a newspaper columnist, and I've been one now for 14 years, you do hear from readers. And not surprisingly to anyone in this room probably, I have found that not all readers are happy with me. A recent exchange from a male reader resonates for me this morning. He wrote to me and said, Madam, our newspaper runs your articles. Every single time, for years now, you insert your opinion. This is not journalism. And I wrote back and I said, dear sir, I am a columnist. That means I am a journalist paid to give my opinion. And he wrote back and he said, well, I disagree with every opinion you write, so how can that be journalism? But you did write back, which surprised me so much, I just read it to my wife. Now she's mad at me for what I said to you. So I guess you won that one. I'm here to share a few of my opinions with you today and to tell a story or two, because that is what I do. In the fall of 1975, my parents loaded the trunk of their Chevy Cavalier before driving 75 miles to Kent State University, where the size of the student enrollment was slightly less than the population of my hometown. I was so scared. After they moved me into my dorm room, I walked my parents back to the car, and then I lingered a bit. This, after months of insisting to anybody who would listen that I couldn't wait to leave my small town life behind. My mother was unusually tearful, reminding me to write. My father offered his version of a hug, patting my back with both hands as if he were putting out a campfire. His only advice, don't blow this. I was the oldest of four children and the first in my family to go to college. From my earliest years in elementary school, my parents talked about when, not if, I would go. Chuck and Janie Schultz, my parents, thought they were two nobodies, but they were going to raise four somebodies. All four of their children graduated from college. They were two people, and we know, and Dean and I were talking about this earlier because he comes from the same background. They wore their bodies out so that their children would never have to, and both of them died in their 60s. My mom was a nurse's aide. The summer before I left for college, I worked as a waitress, and that was the first time I thought about what those 8-hour hospital shifts were doing to my mother. She'd leave before sunrise, wearing a uniform the color of butter, and return late afternoon, taking time only to change her clothes before she started to cook supper. The one time I dared to complain about my swollen feet, she did not reprimand me. She didn't remind me of how much harder it was for her to work all day on her feet. She just continued to stand at the stove and stir the pot as she turned to me with a tired smile and said, "And that is why you are going to college." My dad was a utility worker. He was one of those guys who showered after work at the plant. During the summer months, I would often sit on the front porch swing and wait for the sound of crunchy cinders in the driveway, the signal that Dad was home. At his lowest moments, he used to say to me, "You could teach a monkey to do what I do." So often, my father would pull himself out of the car and at the sight of me, thrust his lunch pail in the air. "You're never going to need one of these," he'd say. "You're going to college." My 4 years at a state university changed me in ways neither I nor my parents could have imagined. Our biggest endeavors reveal their impact by how they alter the way we see ourselves. For the first time in my life, I entered classrooms led by adults who wanted to know what was on my mind. College was a place where the professors took me seriously. I can't overstate the impact of that on a working class girl used to being either ignored for her gender or reprimanded for her big ideas. I mention my parents, my roots, because they had everything to do with how I became a journalist, writing stories and columns about people who are too often anonymous and almost always powerless. When people ask me why I keep writing such stories 30 years later, I tell them a story about my mother. I grew up in Ashtabula, Ohio, a little town people most people notice on their way to somewhere else on Interstate 90. It was my job in the summer months to watch my younger siblings. But at the end of every summer, my mother would do something special just for me. She would ask a neighbor lady to babysit, and we would go to downtown Ashtabula to the department store on Main Street. Carlisle's, it was called, and had a diner in its basement. This was a very big deal. This particular year was 1968, and I was 11 years old. I had a toasted cheese sandwich, tomato soup, and a milkshake. Some things you just don't forget. I remember the waitress treating us like family, like so many waitresses do. And we had the nicest time until right towards the end as we were waiting for our check. Our waitress was waiting on another table. The customer was a man wearing a suit, and he was yelling at her. I don't have any memory of what he said, but I recall her saying over and over, "I'm sorry, sir. I'm so sorry," until she ran off in tears. My mother, all 4 feet 11 inches of her, not counting her beehive, turned toward him and tried to stare him down, but he would not look at my mother. So she finally turned to me and said in a very loud voice, "Honey, don't marry him until you see how he treats the waitress." What Mom meant, of course, was how we treat the people we're allowed to mistreat is the measure of who we are as human beings. We all have bad days. Whenever we resist unloading our frustrations on someone who has to take it, we telegraph our respect for them and we affirm our own resilience. With every act of kindness, we make certain we have not become what we loathe in others. My mother's lesson in the diner has stayed with me my entire career. Now, this is often the moment when I talk to graduates about the importance of being activists for kindness, but it's important to know one's audience, and I think you've got that one covered. One of my dear friends, the Reverend Kate Matthews Huey, often patiently engages me in discussions about common notions of compassion and justice, as if we have to strike a balance between kindheartedness and activism. Traditional definitions cast compassion as sympathy, even pity. But I offer a different one, shared with me in the late 1980s by a social worker I met at Metro Hospital. She said, "Compassion is doing whatever is necessary to heighten awareness." Compassion is doing whatever is necessary to heighten awareness. If that is how we define compassion, we are always doing the work of justice. Most people want to be good. Most people want to make a difference in the world. They want justice. But most people feel pretty helpless to do that. Most of them feel ignored. They are waiting for a reason to make what civil rights icon John Lewis calls necessary trouble. I learned a lot about this notion of necessary trouble and learned a lot about the inherent goodness in people after I wrote about a tip jar in 2004. Sherrod and I were attending, it was an event for a nonprofit actually, a charitable event, and it was at the most popular party center in the city of Cleveland. You could tell by the women who are waiting on us. I mean, first of all, they are all women of color, virtually all of them. All of them worked part-time. None of them got any kind of benefits. One of those women was standing behind the counter at the coat check at the end of the evening. And this was a large crowd, so it was a long line as we waited for our coats. I was standing there watching her, and you could tell that she was tired. But I also noticed there was this giant glass jug. I mean, it was a jug. and it had on it a sign labeled tips. And it was brimming with money, not just singles. There were a number of fives. I saw a 20 and a 10. I mean, it was almost filled to the top. So when it was my turn to hand her the ticket for my coat, I said, "You look like you'd like to get home." And she shook her head and she said, "I am so tired." And Sherrod was standing behind me, and I pointed to the tip jar and I said, "Well, at least you get these at the end of the night." And she said, "Oh, we don't keep the tips." And I said, "What do you mean you don't keep the tips? Who keeps the tips?" And she said, "Management keeps the tips." And I said, "What?" And I heard Sherrod behind me say, "Oh, no." The following Monday, this was a Friday evening, the following Monday I called the management office of the party center, and I got a middle manager, a woman who started yelling at me pretty quickly, and she said, "Connie, why are you asking this? Nobody cares who keeps the tips." And I said, "Oh, I think they do." And she said, "Nobody's ever asked who keeps the tips." And I said, "That's because you have a sign that says tips, and people are assuming it goes to the woman behind the counter." Well, in my profession, you know you're onto something when 2 hours later you get a call on speakerphone from two vice presidents of the company and you didn't call them. You really know you're onto something when the first words out of one of the men's mouths is, "Connie, there's no story here." I laid out to them what I just told you, and I said if they were willing to change their policy, that's the story I would do. But they assured me that nobody cared who keeps the tips. I wrote the column, as I've just told you, and I ended it with this. I simply said, "They say you don't care who keeps the tips. I think they're wrong. What do you think?" They changed their policy by 11 a.m. the next morning on the most popular radio show in Cleveland. And the reason they did that is because thousands of readers started weighing in, not just with me directly, but at the party center. They're calling into the radio show who read the column online. And I learned something really valuable in that moment. That's what I mean when I tell you I know most people are good people. Most people want to make a difference in the world, but they don't know how. And that's something you'll be doing day in and day out. You're showing them how. In this current political climate, we have many opportunities to make necessary trouble. Certainly in your chosen profession, with your conscience finely tuned to justice, you see such opportunities in your every waking moment. I run a public Facebook page. It's got about 152,000, I don't like to call them followers because that sounds like a cult. Let's call them subscribers. And we have discussions every day, and I insist on civility. And most of the time we manage it quite well. But I have noticed a trend in recent months where someone will show up and call either me or liberals in general libtards. Most of the time, I just deleted the comments, but finally I'd hit my breaking point. And so instead, I posted a photo. It is a black and white photo. I am a kindergartner riding on the back of my uncle, my arms wrapped around his neck, my bare toes pointing to the ceiling as I peek out from behind his head. In the background, my grandmother's wet laundry hangs from little hooks along the archway, which tells me this is a photo in the dead of winter in the snow belt of Ashtabula County. This is what I wrote to go with that photo. Today I deleted several references to libtard in comments thread on my wall, as I always do when I see the word. A reader privately suggested I grow a thicker skin if that word bothers me. I was going to brush it off, as I usually do, but then I thought about why the word bothers me so much. His name was Francis, Uncle Francis, to my siblings and me. He was my mother's brother. In this picture, he's in his late 20s, holding up 5-year-old me at my grandmother's house. He was my mother's big brother in size and chronology, but not in aptitude. She was fiercely protective of him until he died in his 50s. Only family members could understand his speech well, and so he tended to be very quiet in other people's homes and in public. I remember cuddling with him on the couch as a child to watch TV, he loved cartoons, and sitting on the floor with him to play with his toy cars. He was polite and gentle, and the object of unkind remarks and stares from strangers all of his life. Call me a liberal and I'll say thank you. Call me or anyone on this page a libtard, and your comment will disappear. I hope this helps to explain why. What unfolded, of course, I don't even need to tell you, I suspect you already can imagine in the comments thread, story after story about other people's Uncle Francis, their children, their siblings, their uncles and aunts. We know this. We know there are so many out there who are just waiting for one person to step up and say the word. We must always be ready to make necessary trouble. I know you already understand that. In a world of so many bystanders, you are the upstanders. And that comes with a cost, which brings me to the only bit of advice I have for you. You are leaders in a profession designed to change the world. The most tired and weariest people I know are those who work day in and day out to improve the lives of the forgotten and the ignored. Leadership is lonely, and it is exhausting. The good people you serve take everything you think you have to offer and then ask for more. They're not selfish, necessarily, and they're certainly not aware of how demanding they can be. So often, they meet you at the end of a long and brutal road. They look up to you. They count on you. You're the fixers. You are the lamplighters. For an awful lot of people, you are their last hope. It is humbling to be on the receiving end of such a profound belief in your abilities, of a certainty in the depth and breadth of your generous hearts. It also can be unnerving. And a common side effect of leadership is your belief that you must show no weakness, no flaws. I want to suggest to you that if you think you have to mask your humanness, you will never discover the full capacity of your influence, your ability to heal hearts and mend lives. When I first became a columnist, inevitably women would ask, doesn't that angry hate mail bother you? And these were during speeches when we'd have Q&A. And at first I used to say, oh no, it doesn't bother me. And you know, I realized why that didn't work. Number one, it was a lie. Of course it bothered me. And number two, if I held myself up as somebody different from the rest of them, I couldn't reach any of them. I would never close that distance. Now I'm not about to compare myself to any of you. I get a lot of attention for what I do, and no one is going to call me today because strangers just banged on their door and dragged all of their belongings to the curb, because a daughter has been diagnosed with cancer, and they have no car, no doctor, no idea of what comes next, because someone somewhere has decided today is a day he or she just cannot take it anymore. That's your job. Those are the calls you get all the time. So often, in their saddest moments, you are the only one who holds up a mirror that reflects a better version of themselves. You show them what you see in them. But here's my certainty. People who respect you and who admire you, even love you, and that would include your family and friends here today, are hungry for signs of your own struggles, your own moments of uncertainty that took you on a journey to a different place from where you started. What I'm asking today is that you share your own stories. Why are you here? Of all the ways you could have carved out a life, you chose this. I know it's not for the money. So why are you here? Not only do I think sharing your own story helps others, having to think about your life, your calling, and why you're doing what you do is a process that rewards the author of that story most of all. I often say I don't really know my opinion about something until I have to explain myself in a column. I am here to tell you that when it comes to self-awareness, there is no substitute for asking yourself the same questions you've been asking people who turn to you in the hardest times of their lives. Right now, there's a lot of excitement about development in downtown Cleveland. But Sherrod and I live in zip code 44105, where one of the highest foreclosure rates in the country. We are surrounded by blight. The murder rate in our city is up. Children are being shot and they're dying. The challenge is how to help everyone understand that it's not about us versus them, that it's not about those people, but rather our community, our brothers and sisters. Last October, I interviewed Samaria Rice, the mother of Tamir Rice, the 12-year-old boy who was shot and killed by two Cleveland policemen in a public park when he was playing with an air gun. She told me she watches that video. We've all seen that video, have we not? Those final seconds when her son was still upright with his whole life ahead of him. I watched that video over and over, she told me. I have to. It's the last video I have of my child alive. I see that police car speed up to Tamir. There's no time. There's no time for my boy to understand what is happening. She took a deep breath and stared straight ahead as she continued to speak. He didn't have a lot of suspicions about people. I look at him in that video, and I'm wondering, what are you thinking right now? Do you know what's about to happen to you? In 2008, I was writing about race because we had the first African-American nominated to become president of the United States. I come from the white working class, and I understood exactly what was going on, but I didn't know how to reach a lot of them. And so I turned to our friend, Congressman John Lewis, who barely survived the march in Selma 51 years ago when they crossed that bridge in an effort to fight for the right to vote. He is a hero to so many, including me. And I asked him, I said, John, I'm trying to reach more of these readers. I'm trying to change their hearts. How do I do that? And his advice has stayed with me ever since. He said, Connie, I don't need their hearts. I just need them to do the right thing. It reminded me of what Martin Luther King used to say. You can't make them love us, but you can stop them from lynching us. My goodness, how we need all of you in this world. But please take care of yourselves. Give yourself those quiet moments to watch your world unfold in front of you. Sometimes the emotion of such moments can wash over us and render us speechless. I have lived long enough to know that when I have no words, my heart will readily take over and freeze that memory for times when I start to get a little scared about where we're headed as a country and as fellow human beings. We have a lot of framed family photos on the walls of our home, photos of our four children in every stage of their lives, and now our five young grandchildren. One of the photos is positioned at the bottom of our stairs, so that's the first thing I see when I come down every morning, and it's the memory that lifts me up the stairs at the end of the long days. It is a photo from the hour before our youngest daughter's wedding. The makeup artist has just finished with her face, and Caitlin has turned in her chair to smile at our grandson, Clayton, who is 7 years old. In the picture, his hands cover his face. Because I was standing in the doorway watching this moment unfold, I know why. After Caitlin smiled at him, Clayton's small hands flew up to his face and he said, "You're so beautiful, I could faint." There is magic in those quiet moments when we give ourselves permission to do nothing but take it all in. And now I leave you with one last story. It's about another influential woman in my life, Sherrod and Bob's mother, Emily Campbell Brown. Emily Campbell Brown was born in Mansfield, Georgia, and married a doctor and moved to Mansfield, Ohio. Born and raised in the Deep South, she shed much of that history when she came to Ohio and became a civil rights activist all of her life. In 2008, when she found out that nobody was making an effort to register voters in the poorest part of town, she, every week, loaded her card table in the trunk of her car and drove to a shopping center in the heart of the Black community. Before Election Day, she registered more than 1,000 voters. Emily Campbell Brown was diagnosed with a terminal disease right after the election. She was determined to live to see the first African-American man sworn in as president. And so we got hospice involved, and Bob was with her on the day of the inauguration. She insisted that Sherrod and I go to Washington, and Bob sat with her. We had her hospital bed right in the living room so that she could watch it on TV. A few days later, Sherrod, all the three brothers were helping to take care of her, and the wives, all of us wives were helping too. And one day, it was Sherrod's my turn, and it was one long room, so I could sit at the dining room table and watch this scene unfold. And Emily turned to Sherrod and said, "Sherrod, I would love to hear the song, Beautiful Savior, from our Lutheran hymnal." And Sherrod, being the dutiful youngest son, of course, went into the family library and brought the hymnal out. Now, those of you who know my husband or have heard his voice, you know he talks like this. He sings like this, too. Beautiful Savior. So I'm sitting at the table and I'm watching my husband bent over holding the hymnal, and he's singing three verses of that song to his mother. The very next day, she turns to Sherrod and says, "Oh, Sherrod, I wish our friend Janine were here." And Sherrod said, "Well, why is that, mother?" Now understand, Janine had one of the most beautiful singing voices of anyone we knew. She said, "I would love to hear her sing Beautiful Savior from our hymnal." And I'm watching this, sitting at the dining room table, and Sherrod said, "Well, mother, don't you remember I sang three verses of that song to you just yesterday? And she said, I know, honey, you're better in a group. Well, aren't we all? Let us not forget that. Let you not forget that. You are surrounded not just by colleagues and friends, but fellow warriors for justice. And may you never forget the strength that comes from that camaraderie. Congratulations, and thank you for choosing this for your life's work.
Should we ask for an encore? No. Thank you for a, I won't say it's a talk, but really a message from the heart. Thank you so much, Connie. So what's next in our program? Oh, yes. We're going to have what you've all been waiting for, where we honor each of our graduates individually. We'll honor graduates for the Master of Science in Social Administration degree, and for the Master of Nonprofit Organization degree. Each graduate will come forward and be presented with an academic hood symbolizing the master's degree. After being hooded, each graduate will proceed to receive her or his diploma, shake hands, have a photo op with me, then each graduate will proceed towards the steps to receive a degree pin from our Alumni Association President, Annette Iwamoto. This pin is commemorative and symbolizes your accomplishments at the Mandel School. We'd like you to wear it every day so everyone knows you're a graduate of the school. In addition to our master's level graduates being celebrated today, we also have 9 doctoral program graduates that will be receiving their PhD degrees this afternoon at the School of Graduate Studies ceremony. These graduates have devoted an average of 5 years in their doctoral program studies, which has included 2 years of coursework, passing a qualifying exam, and completing a dissertation research study under faculty supervision. They will become faculty members in schools and departments of social work, or will hold postdoctoral research positions immediately upon graduation. I would like to read their names and the names of their advisors to you so that we can honor them for their accomplishments. Julia Kobalski, who was advised by Dr. David Hussey. Unyele Lee, who was advised by Dr. Ana Maria Santiago. Young Sam Oh, advised by Dr. Aloan Townsend. Hyun Young Park, advised by Dr. Elizabeth Tracy. Anna Roma, advised by Dr. Ana Maria Santiago. Michael Salwitz, advised by Dr. Mark Joseph. Tanisha Tate, advised by Dr. Ana Maria Santiago, and Susan Yoon, advised by Dr. Megan Holmes. Before we proceed with the ceremony, let me note that we understand and appreciate your enthusiasm, but in the interest of time and to be sure that all graduates can be recognized, I'm going to ask you to hold your applause and your hoots and your hollers until the end of the diploma ceremony, so they can make sure that everybody receives proper recognition when they are on the stage. I'll now ask the marshals and the staff members and the guest participants to please take your spots. Dr. Robert Fisher will hood our M&O graduates. Dr. David Hussey will hood our leadership fellows. And Drs. Howard Hall and Clara Hall will hood their daughter, Ilya Hall. The remainder of our graduates will be hooded by Drs. Milligan and Joseph. Now Dean Porter will start reading names.
Acacia Gabrielle Cook. Wrong by. Gulnar Barasta. Carissa Harrington. Andrea Hess. Michelle Eileen Holy. Michelle Marie Snyder. Janine Block. Catrice Yarnell Williams. Lisa Bartlett. Rebecca Ann Devins. Doreen Nicole Hip. Ann Bonette Smith. Molly Elise Antimarino. Dina Sonia Balk. Yeah. Ronald Walter Emmanuel Barker. Adeyasola Bass. Colleen Marie Bednar. Sarah E. Beebe. Take your time. Take your time. Come on, take your time. Okay. May E. Bennett. Kelly Bickle. Scott Allen Campbell. Alex Patrick Corcoran. Elizabeth Christine Cornelius. Maya Lewis Cortez. Deborah Crane. Aaron Kirby. Isha Daniel. Rachel Marie Davis. Erica Marie DeWine. Alyssa Monique Dillard. Christina DiNardo. Take your time. Sarah Alexandria Eaton. Allison Barclay Edgerton. Emily Early. Christy Falzini. Mary Farina. Patricia Ann Fitzwater. Henrietta Fletcher Lockhart. Azy Perlene Forbes. Andrea Elizabeth Gaiato. Molly N. Galloway. Emily Louise Gerenser. Larissa Garrick. Emily Rachel Gibbs. Shelley Ann Grayson. Berdana Green. Ilea Elizabeth Hall, who has been hooded by her parents, Howard and Jeannie Hall. Congratulations. Charnell, right. Charnell Denise Hampton. Jennifer Ashley Hannon. Margaret Mary Hannon. Kimberly Renee Harden. Jada Lynn Harris. Casey Marie Helkowski.
Say it again. Morgan.
Oh, Dustin Earl Holbrook. Amanda Rayback. You okay? Catherine Huff. Dwayne Hurt. Pronounce the last name. Patricia Janine Pinto Allendoni. Elise Priscilla Kieber Emmons. Tara Caitlin Knight. Nicole Lynn Kazako.
Middle name. How you pronounce your middle name?
Okay. Joyce Ivy Surfaco Kuma. Megan Nicole Kay. Dola Landis. Brittany Lewis. Gina Marie LaCursey. Benway Low. Pronounce. Trent Liu. Oh. Sam LaPata. Xinlu Lu. Marie Christina Luciano. Danielle Luo. Jose Matos. Leslie McAllister. Sure do. Yalak, right? Yalak Mesfin. Okay. Yalak Mesfin. Sharon Meyer. Monica Salida Michael. Amber Moore. Peter Joel Morahan. Oh. Han Ning. Teresa Louise Olson. Odiri Ugari Obobia. Alexandra Opartini. Kayari Osoni. Melissa Pantel Koo. Come on. Megan Elizabeth Patterson. Elizabeth Payne. Adele Jocelyn Pulaski. Mandela Porter. Robert Richardson. Sharon Sanders. Stephanie Scales. Maddie Diane Scott. Travis Wade Scott. Imani Philip Scruggs.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Hermia Monet Shepherd. Abdur Rahman Sadiq. Maria Slaughter. Akeisha Capre Smith. Slow down. Daria Sudman. Elizabeth Miriam Hart Starter. Carly Marie Tipple. Shunwesa Tien. Kaya Diane Trubiano. Mayjean Khan Kane, sorry, Tubi. Brian David Turk. Paul Joseph Tushman. Catherine Irene Tyler. Brietta Usher. Chelsea Ann Vilk. No, I was holding. Molly Ann Bulmer. Finally, huh? Diana Lynn Warman. Catherine Lee Weaver. Lindsay Wellman. Lindsay White. Wills. Mary Catherine Wills. Katrina Wilson. Tiffany Winters. Yusef Zev Witkus. Ing Chung. And last but not least, Christy Lee Zissler.
Let's have a round of applause. In organizing this event, a great deal of planning occurs. The faculty marshals who participate are very visible, but also there are staff who are working behind the scenes literally for months to bring this about. So I want to thank them for all the work they've done to really give us a great ceremony today. One of our graduates once said, "Once a part of the Mandel School, always a part of the Mandel School." The education you're completing today is the beginning of the next phase of your journey. As you go forth, please remember that you will always be an important part of the school. Please keep in touch with us, share with us what you're doing in your life, and remember that we're here for you. The faculty described to me the contact they have from alumni over the years, people calling up to tell about their successes in their work and also their challenges, and asking for advice. We are here for you. Remember that. This is actually my 15th convocation ceremony as dean of the school. And each year, it fills my heart seeing the people who've made a commitment from their heart and soul to be of service to others. And I want to thank you for that commitment that you made a long time ago, long before you came to the Mandel School, but also one that you're now going to go out with the skills that you've learned here, the sharpening of your intellectual abilities, and most importantly, the connections that you've made with one another to support one another as you go forward. I want to thank you for that and what I know you're going to do in the future. We're celebrating 100 years at the university. Think of all the social workers and nonprofit leaders who've left this school and have had an impact not only in this country, but in 41 other nations around the world. You're now part of that, a part of a great community of change agents. So thank you once again. Finally, we're about to have our procession out. I'm going to ask the people to remain in their seats. I'll lead the procession, first of the platform party, including faculty, and then the students behind me. We'll go outside, and then after the students have all processed outside, we invite you to come out then and to greet them and congratulate them. Also, there's a reception, a really nice reception waiting for you back at the Mandel School. And for the graduates, this will be very special because for some of them, it'll be the first time that they'll see our renovated school. So you get in there, see what was going on behind the chain link fence since last May, and you'll have a celebration with your family members. I'm looking forward to seeing you back there. Okay, so we ask the receptionist to begin, the organist to begin, and we'll start.